band here in Australia. When was it reformed?
It was about 1990, I think, we made the first Yellow Part 2 album. Mm-hmm. And we went on the road in 1991, and we've been working pretty well solidly since then.
Right. You were there right from the start, were you?
No. Well, I joined in 1974 on the El Dorado album. You know, I did all the string arrangements and conducted the orchestra, and I was involved in the studio right through, but I never actually came on the road with the band until 1981. Mm.
But you were involved in Hooked on Classics, that one.
Yeah, that was that's been very kind to me, actually. That was, wow, 1981. I wrote all the arrangements and conducted the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra on that whole series. A lot of people think that classical musicians have got that attitude, but a lot of them are far from it, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of them are far more crazy than rock and roll people. Yeah. A lot more crazy. Especially in Britain, they've got a great attitude, I think, the orchestral musicians here. They're so versatile. Like with the Hooked on stuff, you'd think people would look down their nose at that, but all the guys in the orchestra, they love it.
Hello, I'm Scott Ampleford, and I'm very pleased to welcome Mr. Louis Clark to the Colchester Institute. I'm going to be asking some questions and basically just listening to the awesomeness. Going back to the very beginning, obviously everyone has musical influences and something that makes someone go, right, that's what I want to do. Sort of what were you listening to that made you go, right, I want to be a bass player for a start? What was it that...
Well, the bass thing came later. What got me interested in music was actually going to church, and they had a choir there. And I thought, wow, I used to enjoy listening to the choir, because they're a pretty good choir, you know, proper SATB. They sang it quite well, and it was a big influence, actually, because then I started liking Mozart and, you know, people of that era. Much later on in my life is when I got interested in, rock and pop music. And it was the Beatles that did it. I thought, wow, I've never heard anything like this.
Yeah.
It was so different and so fresh and, you know, and so English. That it was really good. So I thought, well, I want to do something like this. And so everybody in those days, this was in the early, mid-60s, everybody wanted to be in a band, and some people just, you know, had a guitar and they'd play and all that.
Yeah.
And I wanted to play something, so somebody had a bass guitar they were selling for £11, and I thought, well, I'm going to buy that and learn. It seems the easiest thing to do. And that's what I did, and so it sort of went from there.
So what was it like growing up in Birmingham? I'm a northerner myself, and I myself have noticed differences sort of when I come down here and the way people say things and just generally live, and people tend to have different upbringings. So what was it like?
Yeah. Well, actually, I wasn't brought up in Birmingham.
Oh.
I was brought up 35 miles away in a little, real nice, quaint, beautiful place called Bridge North in Shropshire.
Okay.
On the River Severn. And it was a real nice little market town, and I used to hate it. I used to want the big city. I just hated living in Bridge North. And, as soon as I was 17, I left Bridge North Grammar School and found myself a job in Birmingham, because I thought I had a chance of joining a band or something. I played in little bands we formed in Bridge North, but they didn't do anything. And it all kind of grew from there.
Awesome.
And then people kind of regard me as a Birmingham. You know, I picked up the accent and everything.
But obviously you were massively inspired by the Beatles.
Yes.
And were there any particular aspects about the Beatles that really sort of singled out?
Well, first of all, they were English.
Yeah.
You know, because most of the music you're getting on the radio and everything was American. it was original. You know, they wrote their own songs and played their own instruments, and the harmonies were unbelievable. You know, for that period, and it was just all came together at the right time. You know, also their image and everything, and it was a massive influence on me, and I'm still a real big fan.
So then you obviously went off to study and all of that sort of stuff. And sort of what got you into writing orchestrally? Because obviously it's a big jump to go from sort of four-piece rock and pop outfits to then full orchestra.
Yeah, there's a kind of gap to fill in here. When I moved to Birmingham, I started playing in bands, and then I gave up my job. And for about 6 years I played in various bands in Birmingham. And we made a few records. It was with a guy called Raymond Froggatt. He's a Raymond Froggatt band. We made a couple of albums and about 10 singles. Hard in and out of the red balloon. We started having these, adding strings and things to the records. And I see these arrangers come in. And I watched them and I thought, well, that's something I'd really like to do. You know, and so I got some books and all that, and learned something about orchestration. And then I decided I needed a bit more of a formal education, and that's when I left the band and everything and went to the City of Leeds College of Music. And probably the best thing I did, because it filled in all the gaps of my self-taught education. And it was good.
So it wasn't so much the classical, it was a case of seeing arrangers coming in to do the pop and the rock and arranging stuff and that. And so then, obviously, we can't not talk about ELO, obviously, that's the big one. And so how did you sort of get to know them? Was it something you were a fan of the band before, or was it something that came in once you started doing it professionally and someone went, oh, this band's looking for a...
The way I kind of got involved with those, you know, the ELO people, or what became the ELO people, was in the days when I was playing in bands in Birmingham. Well, it was a healthy scene for bands then in the pubs and all that, because they'd have two bands on a night, you know, and so, of course, you'd mix with other bands and all that and go drinking afterwards. And I met Jeff Lynne through that several times. And when ELO was formed, I thought, oh, that's just something for me, you know, that's right up my street. And anyway, you know, I just carried on. So I was teaching for a while. And then Jeff put the backing tracks for the El Dorado album, which is the very first ELO album that went gold in America. Yeah. And also, it's the very first one that featured a big string section rather than just a couple of cellos and violin from the band. And it really took off well. And from then on, he asked me on pretty well all the albums after that.
I suppose that's a pretty big ask, asking you to put the O in ELO, really, isn't it? You know. So obviously, you therefore sort of worked on so many of these great tracks. They're all so memorable.
Yeah.
Do you personally have any favourites or any particular moments, any riffs or licks that you go, oh, that was good writing? Mm. You know.
Well, I think my favourite of all, it was the very first one I did, the El Dorado album.
Nice.
Because it was so fresh and different, and it just lent itself to all that big thing, you know. It was a great production as well, you know, from Jeff. But then it went very more commercial, you know, with the New World Record and Out of the Blue, the real good commercial songs, you know, like Mr. Blue Sky and The Evil Woman and So Many Telephone Lines. It just goes on and on.
Yeah. here, Super Bowl, you said it was Orange Bowl instead, not Super Bowl. So obviously that's a big ask that someone's going, would you like to do this huge, amazing gig?
Yeah.
Sort of, how did that come about for a start?
Well, that was when the Hooked on Classics was really big.
Yeah.
You know, all over the world. And KTEL, the record company at the time, they wanted to have a big promotion thing, and they sorted it out with whatever TV company it was in America to do the halftime show of the Orange Bowl, you know, the big American football game. And it was in Miami. And 81, 82 people from the orchestra and all the administrative staff, they flew us all out to Miami to do this thing. The choreography was all done beforehand, so it was exactly 10 minutes long, the whole piece. And so they wanted me to do an arrangement of exactly 10 minutes of bits and pieces from all the bits and pieces of Hooked on Classics. You know,
wow.
And then they did the choreography to fit the music.
Wow.
And so I did it, and of course we mimed to it. And it was all set, the set was a giant Rubik's Cube, because that was when the Rubik's Cube was really big.
Yeah.
That was in 1982 though. And they wheeled this great big thing out onto the field, and everybody climbed up onto it, you know, with their instruments.
A standing ovation and well-deserved for the London Royal Philharmonic halftime under director Lewis Clark, the man who wrote and scored and directed that famed Hooked on Classics, performing Hooked on Orange Bowl.
Miming away. Oh, it was all good fun, and the crowd loved it, you know.
Yeah.
But the funny thing is, it was quite painful, because the track was about a quarter tone out from the instruments. Fortunately, they just blasted the track out, so we couldn't hear the instruments either. Yeah. But the musicians could.
And then, of course, you went to live in America. You live in America now.
Yeah.
Was that just a case of you sort of just fell in love with the place and thought, oh, this is where I want to be, or was it going where the work is?
I fell in love with my wife.
Oh, there we are. That explains it. That gets away with it. And how long have you lived there now?
27 years. No, we've been married 27 years, so it's about 31 years.
Bloody hell. I mean, that's something I'm very interested in myself.
Can you tell by my American accent?
It's so strong, I could barely tell your English. Do you have sort of any sort of favourite stories about something bizarre or just something fun when you were performing with the band and you sort of...
Yeah,
good tour stories.
Yeah,
and stuff.
Most of the stories to tell are really about. It's not glamorous at all, you know, all the travelling and all that kind of stuff.
Climbing onto buses and.
Yeah, like this tour I've just done, like in Poland, the roads are so bad over there that we have to travel at night. So, you do the gig, and then after the gig, get straight onto the road and travel to the next city and get to the hotel about 4 or 5 in the morning. Oh. Then they get some sleep and then get up and go and do the gig. And same again.
Obviously, you still enjoy it though. It's not too much of a task because obviously you wouldn't be doing it.
I can't do anything else anyway. Well, it's a bit too late to start a new career.
So you got to work with the London Symphony Orchestra on the classic rock albums.
Yeah.
So sort of, how did that sort of come about?
Well, you know, the classic rock albums were doing fairly well, you know, successful series of albums for KTEL. And the producer, Don Reedman and Jeff Jarrett, you know, they knew my ELO work and work I'd done with other bands. And they asked me if I wanted to do a track, you know.
A track.
So I said, yeah, sure. And it worked out. Well, you know, so that didn't ask for another one. And then it just went on from there, and I did loads of tracks for the LSO.
Fantastic.
And then that was the period when Stars on 45 came out. Do you remember that? It was a medley of Beatles songs by a Dutch guy. They called himself Stars on 45, or he called himself Stars on 45. And it was a very clever kind of segue thing for bits and bits of Beatles songs. It was a big hit. Yeah. And so everybody started copying that. You know, like there's a Ampleford Bob Dylan song, everything you can think of, everybody's trying it. And then that's when Keitel came to me and asked me if I'd be interested in doing a similar thing, but with classical music. Now, originally it was going to be done on synthesizers and stuff like that, you know. But I thought that it would make a lot more sense and carry a lot more weight if it was the full might of a major symphony orchestra. And so the RPO was approached to do that. And I just happened to have a session with the RPO doing something completely different. It was more like a classic rock thing. Well, it was a rip-off of classic rock, doing some songs. And we had one session of three songs to start off with, and went to the studio and did it. I said, well, look, I've got this session booked. How about if we sneak this, if I can get it done in time, sneak this classical medley into the session? Well, we were in the studio and did the ones I was supposed to be doing. Then we did the, became hooked on classics.
Yeah.
And we went just right through it. And it was great, because every time we went from tune to tune, all the orchestra went, whoa! And it really went, oh hell, you know, and it all grew from there.
Something I did always sort of wonder about the Hooked on Classic stuff, because obviously that was 1981, and every decade seemed to have some sort of classical resurgence again. I mean, in the 70s you had so many awful disco arrangements that you know, Walter Murphy doing Beethoven and stuff like that, and I was wondering whether it was sort of part of that sort of thing where just someone went, oh, let's make it cool again, and sort of shoved it out there. And
I don't know, just kind of happened, really.
Yeah, so that then sold over 13 million records. Do you have any favourite tracks, any favourite events, any tales from the sessions?
No, I think they were pretty business-like, the sessions. You know, got on with them and did them.
And so you recently performed Hooked on Classics with the English Pops Orchestra.
Yeah.
And many of the original performers.
Yep.
And so, what's it then like to sort of step back into those shoes, into that sort of mind frame after all those years away from it?
It was great. Absolutely. I loved it. I enjoyed it so much. You know, because when I first started doing the concerts, I was very, very nervous. And it was all new. It was just so good to see all those guys again. They all get into it. And, it was a pleasure for me to do it.
And so, what are the plans for the coming year with the English Pops Orchestra?
Well, we're pretty well 99.9% certain that we're going to do a concert in Southend at Priory Park on June 28th, which I'm looking forward to, because there's a good crowd in Southend.
So you're currently performing, you're doing stuff with the orchestra, so what is the sort of the roster on stuff like that? What is the sort of the playbill, and sort of where do you get to with that?
The orchestra formed out of ELO, which when Jeff Lynne decided not to do it anymore, we became ELO Part 2. And then there was legal things about using the ELO, so now we just have to use the orchestra. And basically, we just carry on the legacy and do the hits of ELO. And, you know, we go all over the world doing that.
Oh, fantastic. And I'm sure you're welcome all over the world as well. I know I certainly would be. If I could see it when I'm walking past, I know it's something that I would definitely go, I'm going to that.
Yeah.
You said the orchestra is formed from ELO.
Yeah.
So which members sort of carried on? And
well, now it's just down to me and Mick Kaminsky.
Oh, okay. Originally, when did the orchestra form? When did it first start?
I can't remember when the actual... It just evolved through the... Yellow Part 2 was right up to 2000. It evolved from 2000 to today.
And so, the original forming, how many members of the band sort of carried on into the orchestra? And
well, it just kind of... Just going on. Just,
yeah, slowly.
New ones coming in and...
So I know you've just come back from touring.
Yeah.
So where did that tour take you, and how well was it received?
It started off in Prague, and that was a very good one. Then it was just with the band alone. We did 4 dates in Russia, which is all right. And then... a load of dates in Poland, which was very good, very nice.
Finally, what would you say to any sort of young musicians who are wanting to do the same thing and get out there and be active? What would you say to sort of a piece of advice or a piece of inspiration?
Don't think it's going to come easy. It certainly won't. But, you know, if you've got the go for it, just go for it.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure. And I wish you the best of luck with future tours, etc.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Jeff Lynne, how are you, sir? We welcome you back.
Thanks a lot.
Before we break all of this up and the lights go out and the men are getting their cellos and all of that, would you introduce me to your compatriots?
Yeah, that's Mick there on the violin.
Thank you, Mick. And over here in the rear,
we have Lou. Luke Luck.
Thank you, Lou.
Next.
Dave Morgan.
Thank you, Dave. Let's go to the drummer who's been here on a few occasions in his life.
Bev Bevan.
Thank you, Bev. And on bass.
Martin Smith on the bass. And there's Richard Tandy on the keyboard.
Thank you, Richard, very much for coming back again.